So first and foremost, I welcome you to this India Roundup show of the Defence Review, and we are very grateful to have you on this show, sir. And to begin with, I will definitely give an introduction to you. Vinod Bhatia is a very well-decorated soldier of the Indian Army. He has been decorated with Param Vishisht Seva Medal, Ati Vishisht Seva Medal and Sena Medal. He is a paratrooper and has been the colonel of the parachute regiment. Before retiring, he was the Director General Military Operations. And after retirement, he is a director at Center for Joint Warfare Studies, which is a think tank of Ministry of Defence based out of Delhi. Sir, we welcome you to this first show of defence on India Roundup.
Thank you, Colonel Bhatia. Thank you so much for this opportunity. It's a pleasure just connecting with you as a paratrooper. Thank you very much.
And sir, today, to make it more convenient for our viewers, because as you are aware, the Indian diaspora, some of them would have been born in India and now settled abroad, and some would have been born, they would have taken birth outside India, but want to get connected to the roots in India. So they may not be aware of the complete issue, what is happening. So India-China conflict, I will request you to give a small genesis of the India-China conflict as to why it is existing.
India-China, as everyone knows, is home to one third of humanity, both nuclear armed neighbors, both Asian giants, conjoined at independence. We got our independence together. And then our differences popped up in the 50s when China went and annexed Tibet. We gave asylum to the Dalai Lama, and the headquarters of the Tibet administration is based out of Dharamsala, which is known to all. It is a historical issue. It is a legacy left behind by the Britishers. As we all know, that British and history have not been very kind to India. We were partitioned. Our borders were totally unsettled. There were a number of treaties between states and other states and nations. Let me come back to the context of the issue. India and China share a 3,488 kilometer long border, which is also the Tibetan Autonomous Region mainly, but we share the borders. And we have because these are unsettled borders, these are disputed borders, so what we have is a line of actual control. Now, line of actual control is supposedly, again I say supposedly, is the line up to where we administer our territories and China administers on the north, but that's their side of the territory. Unfortunately, the line of actual control has no common understanding. All borders have four stages: demilitarize, delimit, delineate, and demarcate. So in our case, none of the four stages has yet started. And we have a line of actual control, which is a line of perception. We have a perception of our line of actual control. China has a perception of their line of actual control. Because there is no common understanding, no mapping change, no delineation has taken place, unlike the line of control which is delineated, we have the China's perception of the LAC, and similarly China has India's perception of the LAC. So it's a total confusion, if you ask me. And in this confusion, in this contradiction, we manage the India-China line of actual control. And in this contradiction, we have managed it peacefully from 1975, when the last shot in Angle fired at Phnom Penh, 20th October 1975, till about 15th of June this year, that's about a few days back. We have managed it very, very well. And that shows the strength of the two nations, civilizations, the older civilizations, the commitment and the professionalism, the discipline of the two armies which man the borders. But the contention has always been there. And what has happened now on 15th of June, the unsettled borders, the disputed borders have now become contested borders because of this incident. And these peace and tranquility, which was lasting, which hopefully will also last, is based on four agreements, protocols and confidence building measures, The agreements are 1993, 1996, 2005, and 2013. So based on that, we have ensured peace and tranquility along the border and equilibrium along the border. I will not go further till, of course, you ask me the question.
Another question, sir, which relates to the LAC, because as the people understand, the LAC is a part which is an Aksai chain, which was taken over by China in 1962. It's an Indian territory. What is the credentials of this LAC, which is part of India only?
Yeah, okay. Excellent question. I should explain that. Because we have disputed borders, China claims a little over 110,000 square kilometers of our territory and also occupies 37,422 kilometers of our territories in Ladakh, which they call the Aksai chain. The boundary actually of the Kunlun Mountains, but they occupy about 37,244 kilometers of our territories in Ladakh. In addition to that, about 5,175 kilometers of the Saksham Valley, which is occupied by Kashmir, has been ceded to China in a 1963 agreement. But the agreement is categorical; it is subject to the final resolution of the J&K dispute, as per the China and Pakistan thing. As far as we are concerned, J&K is not disputed. J&K, the complete J&K, is an integral part of India, whether it is the territories occupied by China, which is about 43,000, including the ceded territories, and also the Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, including the Gilgit-Baltistan area. So that is where the whole thing lies. We should have no doubts that this is Indian territory integral to the Union of India.
Sir, with this very good explanation, sir, and especially for the Indian diaspora, they would understand as to what LAC is and what the situation today arises is. My next thing is, of the current situation, if you could give some insight of the development that took place from May onwards till 15th of June. So what are the reasons for this escalation, sir?
Okay. Like I said earlier, I should also mention that we have about 1597 kilometers of international boundary or boundary with China in Ladakh. And then we have a boundary in Himachal and Uttarakhand, which is 525 kilometers, 220 in Sikkim, and 1146 in Arunachal. And China also claims a few hundred kilometers central sector, middle sector, as we call it, in Uttarakhand and Himachal, as also it claims about 70,000 square kilometers of Arunachal, which it calls the South Tibet. So this is the complete issue. Coming down to the recent incident, China actually started, there was a, in 1986, it went, came and occupied a place called Sumdrongchu, which is around Sumdrongchu, in 1986. Post-86, we opened 75 diplomatic relations. And when it occupied, we went and occupied higher heights out there. And that took lasted about 6 years plus to resolve. Thereafter, general peace was maintained. We had transgressions, what we call transgressions across the LAC. They blame us for transgressions. We blame them for transgressions. And when the transgressions are there, this is a common area, which is claimed by us and claimed by them. So whenever their patrols come, our patrols go, and we have a face-off. And the face-off is we don't let them come into our territory. And when we go there, they don't let us come into their territory. So that is what a face-off is all about. But the face-offs have been generally very peaceful. In Devsang in 2013, April, was the first major standoff. And I was a DGM at that time. And it happened on 15th of April 2013 in a place called Raki Nala in Devsang, which is from sector north, very near to the area of Galwan where the present incident taken place, which is north of it. And but it was again resolved peacefully through the means which I established already, through the military talks and through diplomatic talks. Thereafter, in 2014, when President Xi Jinping's first visit was there to India in September 2014, there was a major standoff in Chumar, which is again an international border. But some of our area is claimed by China, but it is under our, we are administrating that. It is our side of the LAC. So that happened at the border. And that actually was a setback to the visit of President Xi. It was the first visit to India after having become the president in 2013, and also the first being hosted by Mr. Modi after taking over the prime minister. Thereafter, again, peace and tranquility prevailed for some time. And then 2017, we had a case of in what we generally call Doklam. Actually, it was Dolam. I've been the fourth commander there, also a commander brigade there. So Dolam is a territory actually integral to Bhutan. It's in Western Bhutan. It's not in India. But then we have a 2007 treaty with Bhutan in which we have a mutual security agreement. In that, whenever the security of either Bhutan or India is threatened, the other country will come to its aid. So we went under that treaty to aid Bhutan and stop the construction of the road which is going to jump in, which overlooks the Siliguri corridor and it's our security concern. Because the Siliguri corridor is a narrow corridor which connects 8.5 states. Over 5.5 crore people of our nation. So we cannot afford any intervention to that corridor. Thereafter, we had the very well touted informal meeting at Wuhan, the strategy guidance issued, and then that was on 18 April, and then 2019 October, we had President Xi Jinping coming to Mahabalipuram for the second informal meeting. Why I'm giving the chronology? Because it is a must to understand that to comprehend what has happened now. After that, 2019 October, what has changed is this time the inclusions have taken place in multiple places. I had written a paper in 2018, Beyond Dolam is Army Future Ready. In that, I had said that the incursions by China will increase in scope, in frequency, in depth, and intensity. And that is exactly what we have seen in April, May, in May actually of 2020. There was 5th of May in Nakula in Sikkim, which is a very rare one because there's no dispute out there whatsoever. And then we had three of them in Eastern Ladakh, Galwan, Hot Springs, and Pengongso, North Bank Pengongso. So that is the three inclusions which have taken place. And the reasons for that are very interesting. The reasons, I don't think, okay, I'll let you ask a question.
So my one more thing which has come to our notice after going through certain things is that there is a lobby in China itself which is trying to destabilize Xi Jinping. And after the American and China conflict, that economic conflict, India became the second point which they thought that will be an ideal place, ideal location for carrying out this decentralization activities. What do you say about that, sir?
You're absolutely right. We should look at the strategic signaling which comes out of Beijing. These are tactical actions, but they got strategic significance. We have to understand that these actions are not merely for tactical advantages on the ground. China at this point of time would not give priority to it. The priority happens to be in a post-COVID-19 emerging world order where China is under pressure because the Made in China coronavirus has been there. China feels isolated. And it also sees a rising India, a rising, responsible, resurgent India, which is the testimony is 182 votes out of 194 votes for India for the UN Security Council. So that is testimony to India's growing power and global leadership. China would not want India to be pushed towards the US as it challenges the US. What happens in the emerging world order, India becomes a balancing power. So that is one of China's major fear, that if India was not to is to openly support the US, then China will take many more years to challenge US for world supremacy, which is a stated aim. Then internal trouble definitely is one of the positive factors for the intrusions. Another positive factor is the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, which is the China dream of the BRI. And the CPEC, which runs through Pakistan-occupied Kashmir, which is Indian territory, China invested about $64 billion there. And that is central to the China dream as it gives China access to the Gwadar port and the airfield Gwadar, which is Chinese control for the next 40 years, 2013, the end of time. So it is another 33 years China has got the control.
Another, I come back to my the previous question is, now, as of date, what is the situation in Galwan Valley, sir?
Galwan Valley has to be understood. Galwan Valley, there are three major rivers which flow from west to east in eastern Ladakh and join the Shyok, which generally flows from northwest to southeast. So, and joining the Indus thereafter. So, Galwan was one of the points where the where we have a thing, petrol point 14, 15, 17. Where we generally go and patrol up to, which is the LEC, the de facto LEC. China changed the status by coming and occupying the heights on overlooking the Galwan River, which also gave it a line of sight access to the road, which is the Darbuk DBO, Shyok DBO road. But the road in existence is we started building around 2000. It is not new. The only thing new is that we operationalized the bridges in 2019 and making it accessible in summer also, because otherwise summer the water in Shyok used to overflow and we could not access that in summer. So that is the change that happened out there. Then it had occupied heights in Hot Springs, and a major phase of standoff has been going on in Pengongso North Bank, basically, because the road is there in North Bank. China claimed up to a place called Finger 1, we claim up to Finger 8, and the ongoing standoff is a place called Finger 4, which is generally about midway. And anyone who controls the banks also controls the lake. The south bank of the lake, the road is not there, very difficult area. North bank, the fingers are there, the road is there. So China came and occupied the heights of the road, heights on the fingers, so that we could not patrol up to Finger 8. So Galwan was a major shift, so Hot Springs some shift. And Finger 4 area was a major bone of contention between India and China along the LEC. This happened in early May. The standoffs kept going. There were seven rounds of meeting, four at the level of the brigade commanders, which is normal, which is as per the agreed upon established procedures, established norms. And then there were three meetings between the regional level, which is one higher level. And then on 6th of June, was the meeting of the top-level commanders, the Leh-based co-commander and the Xinjiang-based divisional commander out there. And they decided to disengage.
So that
means, a decision taken by them.
So that means, will it be correct to say that as on date, that is today, we are in the same state as we were before May 2020, sir?
Yes. I will like to say yes in a way of speaking yes, because the Galwan disengagement was to take place. This incident, unfortunate incident, 15th of June happened at a local level. I do not see any sinister designs in it. They were to go back. They did not go back. The Indians insisted on that they go back, and there was a scuffle. Now it's a very bad scuffle in which we have lost 20 of our soldiers, even martyred, including the commanding officer. But on the other side, they were carrying weapons. A lot of people are saying they're not carrying weapons. I don't believe that. The SOP is very clear. You always carry weapons. A weapon is an appendage to a soldier's body. It is not, he never moves out a weapon anywhere. And they did not fire because they could not fire. It is not that they were not allowed to fire. The SOP says that you will not fire on a normal face-off. But the face-off is not normal. It turns ugly. But when it turns ugly, you're in body contact with each other. So who fires at whom? And this is nearing evening, nearing night. So how do you fire at each other? So a lot of people asking questions, why did they not fire? Who held them back? No one held them back. Even the Chinese did not fire. The Indians did not fire because firing was not possible. Let us respect the decision of the leaders on the ground who are controlling the situation. If they've taken a decision in the face of grave danger, in the face of, they lost their life. So a decision is taken out there. Let us respect the decision and let's not question the decision.
Sir, I definitely agree with you and that we should not question the commander because they are the best judge. And by sitting out away from the scene of action, it's very, very difficult to comment. So we definitely we should respect the decision of the commanders at that level, sir. Coming to my last question, sir, because of this Galwan Valley, how do you see the future engagements with China? Will it be redefined or will there be a change in?
There is going to be a major change because the public sentiment is exceedingly important. China has to understand that India will stand firm. India's territorial integrity and sovereignty are non-negotiable, and China has been pushing us, and India is not going to give way. India is going to stand firm. Our stance on the line of steel control, as I put it, as I've been putting it for many years now, is very North stance, is very simply stated stance, is no blinking, no brinkmanship. We do not blink, we will not blink out there, but we will also not indulge in brinkmanship because we do not want it to escalate and aggravate. A peace along our border, peace and tranquility equilibrium is in the interest of India, it's in the interest of China. China cannot afford a war with India. India also does not want a war with China. We should not want a war with China. We do not want a war with China. We are a peace-loving country. Whatever the differences are there, they can be resolved in a very peaceful manner. Something which I had also written an editorial in the Tribune on how to resolve the boundary question. So my point is that with this incident now, we'll have to change the rules of engagement. We'll have to review the agreements which are there. They were robust. They ensured a fragile peace, but they have outlived their time. And 2013 was the last one. I was the DG when it was signed, the Border Defense Cooperation Agreement. It was to proceed forward. We were supposed to also have a telephone link, a hotline, as they call, between the DGMOs, like we have in Pakistan. That has not materialized. I think we'll have to sit down together and the first disengagement has taken place. They are back in their own positions. Now de-escalation will have to take place. After that, we'll have to stabilize the sensitive situation and then see the way forward. I'm sure China would have seen that India will stand firm, and this is not the way the military coercive. This is actually coercive activities by China. Let's face facts. And it has indulged in it successfully earlier, and this time it's not been successful because India as a nation has stood together.
Thank you very much, sir. And I think with that, I come to our end, and I am very grateful and thankful to you for having given us this insight into the present Indo-China conflict. However, in times to come, there are a lot of other areas which needs to be addressed, like the G7, where the India has been called upon by the United States. The situation that is developing in South China Sea, those areas. So definitely in next of roundup, sir, we will definitely take your inputs on those. With that, I end this show for the viewers here, sir. And we are very, very grateful to have you on this show, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Kalam Bhargav. Thank you so very much. It's been an honor and a privilege. Thank you for the opportunity. A wonderful talk to you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, sir.